There goes Davis.
Oh, my gosh.
Davis is going to run it all the way
here
back.
Here comes pressure. Bortles sees it coming. Looking for Wharton in the end zone. Wharton behind the defense. Oh!
Are you kidding?
What position you're supposed to be playing, but the next man in is up. The right way with integrity, and you find a way to win the game.
He is popped and dropped.
Our kids never quit, and they come back the next week and they're resilient.
He's in for the touchdown.
Right to the goal line, spinning into the end zone.
Baseman is wide, Hunt throws into the end zone. Touchdown.
Jerome Smith busting through the pile. Play fake, the throw too high. Almost, it is intercepted by Wingham.
Never, ever, ever give up. Never.
Football season in Central New York. It is the annual spring football game for the Syracuse Orange on display right here on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel from the Carrier Dome. We have an action-packed day for you with Voice of the Orange, Matt Park, Jason Benetti along with you. Last we saw the Orange, it was the Texas Bowl and a victory for Scott Schaefer's bunch. What do you expect to see today?
Well, I think you have to start first, Jason, with what we won't see today, and that's obviously players like Jerome Smith that's foregone his eligibility entering the NFL draft early. Team leaders like Mackie McPherson and Jay Bromley gone from last year. In fact, they'll be working for us a bit today. And the players that, for whatever reason, injury and suspensions and that type of thing, aren't available for spring ball. So you'll see starters like Darrell Eskridge, who was last year's leading tackler, not playing today. Nick Robinson on the offensive line has shuffled it there because he's unavailable. And because there are so few offensive linemen, we'll see an offense versus defense format today instead of splitting the squad into two teams.
You mentioned Jay and Mackie, and Danny Liedtke, also a part of our coverage today. He's downstairs. Hi, Dan.
Good morning, Jason. Hey, we'll have a great field side view of this scrimmage. Should be a lot of fun. And as Matt alluded to, we're going to have Mackie McPherson, Jay Bromley, going to give us a really unique perspective into what's going on in the field. And at halftime, how about an orange legend at halftime with me? We're going to be speaking with Floyd Little, always a lot of fun. He's tons of energy. Going to talk to him a little bit about the tradition and how we're going to move the needle forward for orange football. Guys, back upstairs.
A lot of players to tell you about, Dan. There's Terrell Hunt, who emerged as the starting quarterback last year. It'll be very individually based today, but we do have a team game, and we have an all-new scoring system for you. Matt, take us through the points.
Well, not as convoluted as we've seen in years past. The offense will score in the conventional means, and defense really incentivizing stops, of course, and turnovers. They could have a 13-point play, for instance, with a pick six. It's a pick 13.
It's a pick 13. Big scoring swing. We'll see if one of those happens early on. We'll hear from Scott Schaefer and some of his assistants as well throughout our coverage. A lot to tell you about the Carrier Dome spring game on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Back to the Carrier Dome. It's the spring football game. Syracuse taking on Syracuse. The offense and the defense will go at it coming up shortly. We'll see some drills as well, some punting at halftime. But as folks watch this at home, Matt, if I'm sitting in my living room and I'm saying, what should I be looking for today? What's the answer to that?
I think development of depth, number one. The coaches are always going to tell you in spring ball, especially the spring game, let's just get through it with nobody else getting hurt. There's a couple of injuries. You can see Chuck Buller, the defensive coordinator there. And right next to him is Darrell Eskridge, the hard-hitting safety that was last year's leading tackler. He's been held out of the spring with various injuries. And then as you look at the offensive line here and defensive line, in this case, Eric Kroom is a regular. He'll be back at the defensive tackle position. Marcus Coleman, 55, will be one of those guys that will be asked to fill the gap left open by Jay Bromley's graduation. So who is stepping getting into these open spots? Who can really go into the offseason with some momentum? People that have had conditioning concerns, where are they now? What type of agenda do you have for them for the next few months? Because this is really the last official contact players and coaches will have until August. It's going to be on the team leaders from here on out.
It's important to note, too, that this is part of spring practice. It just so happens that this is on a grander stage. So you got 15 practice sessions, and this is just the last one.
Right, and this day is part of selling the program. You'll hear Scott Schaefer out there. They have the recruits in town. The banquet was last night with some 500 people at Manly Fieldhouse, and it's about selling tickets. You know, you look around the Carrier Dome, and there's all kinds of these multicolored and color-coded seat markers that show you what's available here and the prices, and so people have an opportunity to do that. And one thing that's fun about the spring, and this is a really kind of an unprecedented spring game broadcast for us, is that we'll have some interaction with the coaching staff and some of the recent and current players.
I thought you just went a little crazy with your post-it notes earlier. There's orange ones all over the place, and blue ones and green ones, and season tickets starting at $99. I mean, that's a pretty good deal.
You know me, I am a sucker for color coding. And so here we're zooming in on the 300 level, and those seats are in that orange or salmon. Those can be had for $225, and there are seats as low as $99, $125. Right there is a look at A.J. Long. It's an early enrollee freshman at quarterback, and we'll be looking. Terrell Hunt has the job right now. It's his to lose as the number one quarterback for his work last year. He was named the team MVP at the banquet last night, but Long vying for that number two spot along with Mitch Kimball.
You know, it's interesting from year to year exactly how a program shapeshifts, because last year we'd be looking at the reserve quarterback and saying, who's it going to be? What's it going to be? But now with that position solidified, you can basically let the younger guys let it rip and see what you have.
A year ago at this time, you were looking to replace a three-year starter that had just been a high draft pick, Ryan Nassib, to the New York Giants. You were talking about this guy, maybe Drew Allen. He's coming in from Oklahoma. Looks like he would have the starting job to lose. It just didn't work out with Drew Allen. Terrell Hunt overtook him early in the season and proved to be a team leader. A lot of the best moments of last year Terrell was involved in, including the game-winning touchdown in the Texas Bowl against Minnesota. This is a program now that's won bowls in three of the past 4 years. The arrow is very much pointing up. The enthusiasm of the ACC, the new uniforms, etc. They're recruiting at a higher level, and this is just another step in it today.
So it's the Syracuse football spring game today with Matt Park, Jason Benetti, our entire crew. Danny Leek is down to the sideline. Mackie McPherson, Jay Bromley with some insider tips as well as to what we'll be seeing. A couple of halves worth of football actually played here. What do you think of the format? Give you a better opportunity to see individual effort?
Yeah, there aren't a lot of options when you don't have, let's say, 12 to 15 offensive linemen to throw in there. There just aren't enough for both teams to split up sides, as they've done a couple of times here in recent memory. But with the injuries and the shuffling there, they've gone with this format. You'll have the white team on offense, the blue team is the defense, and the coaches evaluating both sides. And they always like competition. The offseason marked by competition, even if it's dodgeball or tug of war. The idea here is to find a winner. Here's Scott Schaefer.
Okay, great. Thanks so much for coming out today to support our kids. You know, we take a lot of pride in trying to put a football team on the field that's yours, and I really want it to be your team. I really appreciate all of you guys coming out today. You know, our goal is to try to continue to increase our attendance next year. Our job is to play good football. For that Villanova game, I did want to just reiterate, we talked about having the opportunity to come out, buy a ticket for Villanova. If you buy a ticket, I'll buy the second one for you. I want to go 2-for-1 on that deal. And I really look forward to seeing you guys come out for that home opener. We talked to our players a lot about it doesn't matter what the circumstances are. If we have a guy go down, it's all about the next man up. And that's our creed. I would like you guys to try to take that same motto and say, we got to get the next fan up. The next guy in my neighborhood who hasn't been coming to the games, the next kid in my classroom that hasn't been coming to the games, let's make the Orange our team in this town. The goal is to have you guys be the most difficult crowd to play in front of when we bring people in here. That's the goal. I want to see this place shake. I want to see this place shake when people come to our town. They come out here, we're going to lock those doors. When they come in here, we're going to beat the hell out of them for 60 minutes, and we're going to enjoy doing it in front of our team and our crowd. Okay, that's enough talking. Let's watch the boys play some football. Here's what we got going on. It's going to be more of a scrimmage situation rather than a spring game because we're a little bit down on some linemen up front, some injuries. The way it'll work is the offense will score points the way they usually do. Score a touchdown, 6 points, kick an extra point. Field goal opportunities, obviously worth 3 points. Now for the defense, if they get an interception or any turnover, fumble recovery, it's 6 points. The thing the blue jerseys want to do is they want to make an interception or get a fumble and turn it into a touchdown because that'll be worth 13 points. So we get a little offense defense rivalry. We call it a civil war. Then we'll go in at halftime, take a little break for the boys, bring them back out. Whichever team is losing, the offense or the defense, whoever's down. Then we're going to have a kicking challenge, a punt challenge, where our punter, Riley Dixon, will come out. We'll have two gunners and two corners covering down the football field. Riley's going to try to punt the ball inside the 15. That'll be worth 1 point. If he kicks it inside the 10 and they down it inside the 10, that'll be worth 2 points for whichever team is down. And if they can kick it inside the 5-yard line and down it, that'll be worth 3 points. There'll be three opportunities to try to even things up after we go with the halftime. So enough of that. Let's get a coin toss here and kick this thing off. Thanks so much for coming, and have a hell of a spring and summer. Thanks so much for coming.
You heard the man. Let's lock the doors and have a civil war. Football at the Carrier Dome coming your way after this. Back here at the Carrier Dome, the alma mater for Syracuse University being played as the colors are shown here at the Dome, the spring football game in Central New York. And we will have football coming up shortly with Matt Park, Jason Benetti, Danny Liedtke, Jay Bromley, Mackie McPherson, our entire crew from the Carrier Dome. As we get you ready for the 2014 spring football game, just a couple of months away from the opener against Villanova on a Friday. National anthem here at the Carrier Dome as the Orange offense and defense get ready to lock horns. We'll check in downstairs field level with Danny Liedtke. Dan.
Jason, thank you very much here with Mackie McPherson. Mackie, back in here for the spring game. You're on the sideline for the first time in a while. What's it like coming back and seeing the guys suited up, ready to go?
It's different. It's different to see this. I think it's a great thing. It's weird not to be out there with my teammates. But, you know, hopefully they all go out there, play well, show their stuff, and do what they do best.
Tell me some of the things you tried to take away from spring practice, what it meant to you to get ready for that fall season.
Spring practice is really about fine-tuning the things that you learned in the season, the things you learn in practice. You know, it's not about getting ready for a game. It's about becoming a better player. And so that kind of takes some stress out of the whole thing, where you don't have to worry about, gee, you know, I got to go against this guy this week. I got to be careful for this move. You know that you're going against the same player on defense every day, so you're just trying to become the best player you can be.
I'm going to have you step back from being a former player for a minute. How about being a resident of this area for most of your life? And what's it like being a fan and seeing this program, the resurgence? Every year it's a little bit gradual step forward. What's it mean to you to see the Syracuse football program start to restore some glory?
I think it's great. You know, personally, I'm a Syracuse fan. You know, I have been my whole life. And so to see them, you know, keep going up and to be building up their program is a blessing in disguise. You know, you come out here, you see people coming out to the spring game. You know, my first year, there weren't too many people out here. Now we have a decent crowd, it looks like, for the day, and I'm excited to see what happens.
Now you're getting ready to try and put on a show for the next level. Talk to me a little bit about what are the preparations like trying to get ready to make yourself appealing for those folks that are going to pull the trigger at NFL draft day. Certainly being a center is a nice little niche for you. Talk to me about those preparations.
Well, you know, we had pro day on the 26th, and it went well from what I understand. Coach Hicks said I did a good job, our strength coach. You know, just trying to garner interest from teams right now. I've been working on the long snapping thing, which it's been talked about. So just to make myself a little bit more valuable as a prospect, as a center guy, just, you know, hopefully I can get a team to pick me up on that draft whenever that day is. And if not, then sign with the team as free agent and go from there.
Mackie, thanks for your time. Hopefully we can call on you throughout the game here.
You know where to find me. Thank you.
Jason, take it away.
Danny Mackey, thank you very much, and we hope for Mackey's sake, especially the long snapper, you can make yourself a long NFL career just doing that.
He did a little bit of that very early in his career. He snapped for placement kicks. Now he's working on punts, and actually his younger brother Cameron McPherson has come in here from Georgetown to sort of learn the same. Sam Rogers has done a great job in that role here at Syracuse for the past 4 years, and you realize just how important it is, but it might be a niche for Mackey. So the first part of the scrimmage will start at the 35-yard line. Terrell Hunt off a team MVP season, the incumbent quarterback, and a pass play to get it going. Dyshawn Davis coming up, picking up where he left off a year ago. Adrian Fleming on the catch, but it's for a loss.
And now we know for this season the defense is just going to be significantly better than the offense. That sells it right there. One play, right, and it's over.
Well, they say you can tell how the season's going to go by the game's first batter, and in this case, it's Dyshawn Davis and Wayne Morgan combining on a tackle for a loss of 5 yards. So right away, second down and 15. Low snap that time from the new center, and a completion to midfield and into the defense's territory at the 45-yard line for Brizzly Esteem. New number for him from number 20 to number 9, and he's an explosive player.
Well, here's a guy they say is faster now after spring practice, has really built on some already there explosiveness, and what a tight pass from Terrell Hunt down the middle.
Richie Desir led the tackling charge. Tempo is something we'll watch throughout the year. Tough on the television replay crew for sure. And a short run off the left side for a gain of 5. And you can see Marquise Hodge there tackling Prince Tyson Gully. Hodge already down. And those are the types of things that make coaches cringe in spring ball. Hodge, the odds-on favorite to take over for Marquise Spruill as the Orange's middle linebacker.
Well, and Clark Lee, the linebackers coach, was talking about this just the other day about how deep his crew is.
A lot of new faces at the position, two in particular, Marquise Hodge and P.J. Batten. You know, we've had a lot of fun really going through and building this thing up from the bottom. And having two experienced guys like Dyshawn and Cam back is very helpful in terms of, you know, carrying on the progress we made through the last spring and fall. Losing Marquise Spruill hurts. So, but I've been really pleased. We've had a lot of fun. I don't think the middle linebacker position has been solidified yet. I expect a competition in the fall there, but I do think I've seen some good things out of both Marquise and Ollie Vigil. So we're excited about that. Cam has done some great things to fine tune his game and kind of take it to his next level. And so we're excited with him. And then behind him, Alric Perry has really been a surprise for us too. A young man that played only defensive end in high school that we saw some flashes and felt like we'd take a late shot on him. And you know, he's worked really hard to position himself to maybe contribute behind Cam. And then at Sam, Dyshawn again has solidified his spot and had a great spring. You know, last spring we weren't able to work with him because of the surgery. And just been really impressed with his, not only his progress, but also just his day-to-day work ethic and his, you know, taken to a leadership role in the group too. It's been impressive. Josh Kirkland has stepped his game up and is pushing Dyshawn and kind of solidifying his role there as the backup. And then PJ, new to the positions, you know, had a steep learning curve, but we've had a lot of fun kind of getting him through. So it's been a great spring and got a great group of guys really excited moving forward.
Clark Lee, like so many of these assistant coaches, including DeAndre Smith, you see there in his second year under second-year head coach Scott Schaefer. Offense moving down the field here pretty well so far, thanks to a Brizzly Esteem, and then a newcomer as a sophomore that did not play last year, Sean Avant. As you look at Lee, who has that background from Vanderbilt and some of his other stops, very well spoken, and the guys love him. There is an injury on the field right now at a position we were talking about where the Orange are looking to replace a man. We heard from Mackie McPherson, the three-year starter and two-year captain, and now his understudy, John Miller, is helped off with a bit of a limp.
There's some question about the offensive line and who's going to go where, especially considering the injuries in preseason and all that. And the last thing you want, as you mentioned, I mean, you don't want people injured in this type of thing, but you can't ask the players. People are saying, well, then can you play half speed? That'll get you hurt more, right?
Absolutely. During the spring practice period, the 14 practices prior to this one, the players practice with guards over their helmets. So they did just about everything short of bubble wrap to make sure everybody was okay up until now. But when you play football, you're going to have bumps and bruises, and they'll err on the side of caution for sure. But we're starting to see the lack of depth at this stage exposed a bit, and that's to be expected. There's a number of players that are on the sideline, plus you lost your graduates. You don't have your freshmen coming in from next year. So it's first down, and Terrell Hunt remains as the quarterback. This is the first string offense, and his pass batted down as he tried to get it out to Jared West on the near sideline. Micah Robinson, a returning starter at defensive end, got to it.
You know, you don't want to pull out too many themes 5 minutes into a spring football game, but the offense has been predicated, this drive at least, on quick hitters to the outside.
Absolutely. The long handoffs, you want to get the ball in the hands of playmakers like Brizzly Esteem and Ashton Broyled. Figure to see Broyled more on the outside. There's a good block on the screen to West, and he's inside the 10 before getting hammered down by Eric Kroon, the defensive tackle. West coming off a season where he made 26 catches. Broyled led the team in quantity of catches, and we have not yet seen him on the field in this scrimmage. So now third and one inside the 10. Hunt always a threat on the draw run. This time gives to Prince Tyson Gully, and Dyshawn Davis blows it up.
How good was he at the end of last year? I mean, Dyshawn Davis, just about every time Syracuse needed a play, he was in there.
And keep in mind, you're kind of rooting for both teams here, right? So you want to see a play like this made by Davis, who a year ago was just shy of 50 tackles, but really a playmaker. The Orange were very good at linebacker a season ago. Davis figures to be a leader in the 2014 season. So a field goal opportunity, and you talk about where the depth has been challenged. Ross Krautmann and Ryan Norton not in the picture right now for various reasons. And so the man from London, Alex Hodgkinson, out for a look here at what figures to be about a 27-yard field goal attempt. He's got it, and the offense scores the first 3 points of the day.
So 3-0 in favor of the offense, and we check in with Dan Liedtke with another member of our team, Jay Bromley.
Thanks very much, Matt. How much do you look forward to it, especially in a game like this? You guys are outside practicing. Now you get a chance in a live game to go out and hit somebody. How much is that? How important is that to you to get on the field and get physical?
It's very important, you know, for us to go out there and just play hard and compete in a live situation where you get to tackle and do things like that, because you can't simulate that in practice, live periods and things like that, the emotion of how everything goes in the game.
Tell me a little bit about your development when you were here at Syracuse, how you became a leader. I mean, Coach Schaefer obviously is a great role model for you. What was that process like developing yourself into becoming a leader?
Just having great role models ahead of me, the seniors and juniors ahead of me, like Chandler, like Pew, like the Perkins, those guys that were before me that helped me really mold myself in the leader I became as a senior, because those guys showed me right from wrong and what to do on and off the field.
NFL is certainly a dream of yours. What are the preparations like for you getting ready for the NFL draft?
Just staying down to earth and just continue working hard, just making sure I work on little things, just try to figure out how to get better each and every day, stay in great shape, and just try to, you know, push my limits because I'm ready to go into a rookie mini camp and, you know, try to, you know, prove myself that I'm better than what everybody believes I am.
It's pretty clear you're rooting for the defense, yet you're standing on the offensive sideline. I think because I'm here and you need to talk to me. So while you're over here, are you taking advantage of getting over there and talking a little smack to the offensive guys?
It was only the first drive, so I didn't get too much yet, but I'd definitely be rooting the defense on the whole time. And like when Tyson just got TFL'd, I'd definitely let him hear about it.
Good stuff. We'll talk to you a little bit later.
No problem. Thank
Matt.
You.
All right, Danny, thank you. We wish the best to Jay Bromley in his NFL hopes. The first play of the second series blown dead and for a loss. I thought A.J. Long might have gotten a little more credit than he did. They mark him down for a drop 3 yards. All-state player in Tennessee. Graduated early to show up early for spring ball. He'll be a true freshman in the fall. And here a zone read handoff. Not much there as the defensive line is wise to it, including Wayne Williams, a big fella. You see Donnie Simmons there and Josh Kirkland. These are all reserve defensive players that are coming up to plug the run.
Wayne Williams, a guy that Syracuse has some high hopes for, somebody that's trying to get into shape on the defensive line, and with the numbers that's on that defensive line, it might be good news.
It seems like Coach Mack led his original recruiting back in the 80s, because we've been talking about Wayne Williams for a long time, but now he's in uniform. Conditioning certainly a concern for him, but he is a big fella. And there's another sack as Long gives ground, and any number of defensive players, Kirkland, Oliver Vigil, and as well Donnie Simmons could be credited for that takedown. They're blowing the whistle, of course, to keep the quarterbacks from getting hit, but now it's fourth and forever.
But Matt, this is real football. Why not let them get hit? Teach them a lesson.
It's modified football with an asterisk as you look at new offensive line coach Joe Adam trying to get his crew together with some duct tape and baling twine at this time of the year. They can kind of be a little arbitrary on some of these, so this is a new first and 10. First and 10 here after that would have been a punting situation. A.J. Long is the quarterback. Give points to the defense there on a three and out. So the game now tied three apiece. High snap to Long. Still sets up a screen for Ashton Boyle. Low throw and dropped. Incomplete.
You know, one of the things we were talking about is coming from high school to college. And for Joe Adam, that's something that he's been watching with his young players.
It's a bigger mental piece. I think one of the struggles that young players tend to have is the time management skill. You know, and then the other piece is coming into an environment where, you know, they used to be the man on campus, the best player in town. Everybody knew him. They could walk through the hallways and everyone knows that guy. And now they walk into a situation very much like their freshman year of high school football, where they have to reprove themselves. And for some 17 and 18 year old kids, that's very hard to do. To kind of check your ego at the door and just go back to work and show that you can do something at a higher level.
Joe Adam, new offensive line coach, longtime friends with Scott Schaefer, and a guy who has head coaching experience at the smaller college level. Good to see him now as part of the program. Third and five faces the offense now in a 3-3 scrimmage. Low snap to Long. Stands strong in the pocket and hits Ben Lewis for a first down off the right side. Lewis brought down just shy of midfield, a guy that flashed at this time a year ago, made one catch in the 2013 regular season. Chauncey Schism on the stop.
Again, one of those quick hitters that it forces the defense to really come up to the line and make some plays quickly in the passing game.
So now first down at the 49-yard line. Offense got a 27-yard field goal in its first possession and has been stopped on a three and out one time. Long again fielding the high snap. Keep in mind that's one area where the Orange are looking to replace a three-year starter. Looks like now Jesse Wolf-Gould, a walk-on, is in there with John Miller leaving with injury. Devontae McFarland to carry for a gain of one.
Well, it's a good day regardless. You see the kids there. I mean, this is a football game. We have the score for you, and we have a scoring system, but it's a chance for kids to come out and see the football team in an environment where it's just a little looser.
Free admission, free parking, free hot dogs and sodas as well today. It's a great celebration. Autographs after the day for the kids, and so it's a good opportunity for there to be some interaction, and nobody favors that more than Scott Schaefer.
And for the head coach, for Scott Schaefer, a guy that is a community-based guy, somebody who likes to be with the people. You heard his speech pregame. It's a chance for him to evaluate his team one last time, but they don't levy any extra burden on this in terms of evaluation for the coaching staff. This is just one more practice.
And a third and long here. Third down is how football games are won and lost. Long with a pass out to the near side where Jeremiah Cabita is able to make something with it outside the numbers. He's got the first down before getting rocked to the turf at the 37-yard line. So Cabita picks up 12 yards, and Eric Anthony with a stop of what could have been a much bigger play.
You mentioned the blocking earlier. The wide receiver blocking on the outside has been pretty good so far.
Yeah, and the other thing I'm impressed with is that A.J. Long is doing a nice job in ball handling here. The snaps have been all over the map, and he's finding a way to at least execute the play and get it out to the perimeter and the playmakers. Here's a fake and a swing to the right side again for Esteem. And again, Anthony having none of it as he brings it down. And that's not Esteem, but Corey Winfield who makes the catch.
If somebody said to Eric Anthony before the game, hey, listen, we don't want you to hurt anybody, he didn't listen. Those are two pretty big licks for spring football.
Well, some of those guys can make impressions here. They take practice seriously as well, and we always see that kind of spring hero that pops up, and you hope that that carries over into the fall. So now second and short, and long this time to Broyles. Good block by Cam McPherson. Broyles is off. He's got the 15 and is brought down just inside the sideline. Ashton Broyles' first touch for a first down.
Well, there's always a shroud of intrigue around Ashton Broyles, it seems like, and the reports are that he's been moved to the outside almost exclusively this season, and you see the explosiveness.
Josh Kirkland bringing him down from behind, and the Orange hope to see a lot of Broiled this fall. He led the team in tackling a year ago. So now first down at the 14, and Long this time gives up the middle for Devontae McFarland. He's inside the five, first and goal, and the defense thinks the ball's popped free. The officials say no, marked down at around the 5 yard line.
Well, you heard Scott Schaefer. If that turns into a turnover and a touchdown, they get 13 points. They're going to want to pop the ball free as much as they can.
Kirkland got a hand in there. Kirkland's so active, a junior college transfer. Coach Schaefer said he got lost in recruiting him in the middle of nowhere in Kansas. But Kirkland, a very high energy guy, loves football. No first down here. It is second and very short. Floating snap for Long has Broyles, who spins out of a tackle and scores the touchdown from 5 yards out. Ashton Broyles puts the offense up now 9-3. Trying to get it again on the long handoff. Tackle is missed by the walk-on corner from Baldwinsville, Joe Stannard, and Broyles is in.
Alex Hodgkinson out for the PAT.
Alex Hodgkinson out for another kick, this time a PAT. Riley Dixon replaces Charlie Loeb at the holder position for now. And the kick is good for Hodgkinson to make it 10-3 offense.
So 10-3, the offense with the lead over the defense. Clock continues to move. They're going to take a break. We'll step aside as well. More football from the Carrier Dome. See if the defense can get into the end zone after this. Spring football on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. They're not instituting water breaks in the NCAA this year. However, there is one in the spring football game. The offense took it down the field to lead 10-3. Ashton Broyles with a touchdown, Matt. And here's a guy that can really put pressure on a defense. Although, again, this is not the starting defense you're going to see coming up in August against Villanova.
Well, it's also not Clemson's or Florida State's defense at this stage. But Broyles with so much talent, 6'4", 220, so much promise. People are looking for him to bust out, and those are the types of plays where he can do it, make some yardage after the catch. He took it in from 7 yards out. And so now Terrell Hunt, the number one quarterback, back out with a 10-3 lead for the offense. Lots of starters on the defense on the field for the moment. And Josh Paris has a catch off the left side for a gain of 9. Hodge and Richie DeSeer on the tackle.
We talked about the energy in this building today, and Tim Doust is a guy as the assistant head coach, somebody who played at Wittenberg University and knows what it's like to really just care about the game.
I love the game. If nobody gave me a scholarship, you know, I would pay for myself and just finish paying for it. But I want those kind of kids that, hey, we're going to play a game at 6 o'clock in the morning in the parking lot. Will you be there? Those are the kids I want to have, and those are the kids that, like I said, they'll achieve academically. They won't be a problem there. They'll go to class. They'll go to study table. They'll take advantage of the tutors that we provide for them. But that's who I am as a person. I tell my kids all the time, I want to get you more like me. And sometimes they look at me funny, they laugh, but they really bought into it. And I've been here for now 4 years. I'm really proud of the group of seniors I have in front of me, because whether they'll admit it or not, I see bits and pieces of them getting more and more like me.
A lot of energy out of Tim Dowse, great guy, one of Coach Schaefer's very closest friends. They were together at previous stops at Western Michigan and places like that along the way. False start on the offense, first penalty on either side yet today. First down and 15, and Brizzly Esteem with another touch from Terrell Hunt. Cam Lynch, starting linebacker, knocks him down, along with Ron Thompson, a converted tight end. One of those athletes they're trying to get into a position where he can help.
Well, and certainly as a coach in college football, you bring guys in because you like the athleticism, and then suddenly it's, do they fit best in this place, or do we need that person more? And it's sort of that confluence of the two that makes a final decision.
Gain of 3, second and 12, and Hunt going deep on the right side for Esteem, a leaping attempt, and it's pulled out of his hands. Very well done defensively by Darius Kelly, who was a nice find a year ago. Junior college transfer, helped out on punt returns briefly and made 44 tackles.
Third down and 11.
Up in the air, well thrown ball, and Esteem trying to come back to it. Kelly held his ground. Now third and more than 10 here. Kelly lurking in the defensive backfield, and Hunt operates out of the gun with Adonis Amin Moore into his right. Gets a fake. Hunt scrambling now. Dumps it off, and the catch by Tyler Provo, short of the line to gain, and Julian Wiggum wearing a new uniform number 1, in there to turn him down and force what would be a punt for the offense.
Good to see Julian Wiggum back after the injury last year, all healthy, all healed up, and he's a guy that provided some good work in the secondary for Syracuse, and, you know, after what he went through, it's just tremendous to see him back on the field.
Wiggum, through his early years, dealt with esophagus issues, had surgery, got popped in that Florida State game, and didn't play the last 3.5 games.
Let's check in downstairs. Danny with Mackey.
Hey, thanks very much, Jason. Mackey, a game like this, you haven't been on the field in a while. You've done a lot of workouts. What's it like trying to get your legs underneath you in a real game where you're actually hitting each other?
I mean, you've been practicing for 14 practices before this, so you're used to hitting again. This is just kind of the fun part of it now. You get to go out there and hit people. It's a live situation. You know, unfortunately, we had a couple guys go down a little bit, but I think they're back in the game now, and it's awesome to watch these guys go out there.
Yeah, with that being said, I mean, you've got a crowd here. You want to put on a show. Any hesitation, being that your teammates on the other side of the line, or are you just out there to kind of make your mark?
Well, you know, obviously you don't want to take any cheap shots or go any low blows on the knees. But, you know, I mean, it's all fair in the game. You know, you go out there, if it's legal, you can do it. So that's how we do it out here. And you know, some guys get banged up, but that's how the game goes.
Yeah, we heard Jay a moment ago. He's pulling for the defense. So I hope it's safe to assume you're cheering for the offense.
Oh, come on. Yeah, I got to cheer for the offense. My brother's on that side.
Yeah. How would you say, I mean, so far, what have you seen from your perspective on the sideline here early on in this game? Just the first half, obviously.
I think the offensive line looks good. The first team offensive line looks real good. I haven't seen them run the ball too much, but they've been doing a lot of bubble screens, and that seems to be working pretty well for them. And my brother threw a nice block on one bubble screen out there on the right sideline, so it was fun to watch that and just go out there. A lot of explosion, looks like.
I see you're putting on a show over here, like a punting technique. Any chance that's in your future?
No, that's long gone. That was long gone days.
Yeah, I never tried it either. Back upstairs, Jason.
That means it was there at some point, though. From Matthew, we got to go back in the annals.
Well, it seems like it wasn't that long ago he was a ball boy down on the sideline, he and his brother Cam, another big guys. Mackey, NFL hopeful, and Cam back and has really filled out. He was a quarterback at CBA, now a tight end here for the Orange. Terrell Hunt running the offense, hits Adrian Fleming again, who steps out of the first tackle and then takes Richie Desir for a ride up the sideline before Wayne Morgan can get him out of bounds.
that's something if you're watching at home in a spring game. Speed is something that you just can't fake. I mean, it's there whether or not you're being chased by somebody else. That was a pretty quick move by Fleming.
Another look here, and Hunt's throw accurate. Fleming able to step out of a tackle and then carry another couple. Cam Lynch looked like he had the deciding blow there. First down on the right hash mark, and another tipped ball reeled in anyway. Fleming would be better served in a real game to knock that one down and not drop the yardage. Richie DeSeer on the coverage. So second and 14, there have been a lot of long down and distance situations for the offense.
Yeah, and that's something you obviously don't want to get involved in a regular season game, but you got to work on it too. See where they go.
Stepping into the pocket, another deep ball for this time Fleming, thrown by Hunt on the money, and Wayne Morgan ripped it out of the hands of Fleming up the right sideline.
A lot of double numbers on this roster right now, so you got to look at the names on the back. Morgan and Funderburk wearing number two, but not a bad ball down the sideline.
No, good ball. Little bit of a wobble to it, but still on the hands of the would-be receiver, Adrian Fleming. Morgan, a junior now from Brooklyn, a guy limited last year by knee injuries, but still effective with 21 tackles. And now we face third down and 13. The offense's points coming from a 27-yard field goal and a 7-yard scoring pass. Coming back to the ball is Alvin Cornelius, upended in the open field by Chauncey Schizo.
But Matt, how could a defense have 4 points?
That's right. The defense has four based on, I think, generous scoring. A three and out. They got 3 points for that. And the second one, I guess, for a stop on downs. But that would have been a punting situation. The last time out, they keep it a little fair here, kind of moving it along. So let's just call punts are also a point. So 10 to 5 now, another punt.
The good news is at halftime, the defense will have a chance to catch up with a punting exhibition put on.
If, in fact, the defense is trailing at that time.
Right.
Whatever the trailing team is, Riley Dixon will suit up for it. Riley Dixon is one of the really rock-solid players at his position, and people might, you know, say that's not important or joke about it. You know what? Punting is important, and the Orange have been blessed here for a series of years. Brendan Carney to Rob Long to Riley Dixon out of CBA. All have been very good.
And we've talked about, too, recruiting locally. You have somebody like Riley Dixon out of CBA. We've mentioned Eric Anthony a couple times with a few tackles from down the road at Baldwinsville, and you know, you dot the roster with a couple of those players, but Riley Dixon has been tremendous.
He has, and a guy that's very good in the classroom as well. Looks like he'll take over the holding duties, at least for the time being. Averaged 42 yards per kick last year. Look at Chuck Bullock back for his second year as the D coordinator.
Chuck Bulla, that second season, has some NFL experience, college experience with the Miami Dolphins back in the 90s. But this is a defense that is rebuilding in a couple of spots. We heard about the depth at the linebacker position. The defensive line, they're sort of shape-shifting at this point and hoping that somebody steps up defensive tackle-wise. And we'll see as they move along in practice who that might be.
In major college and pro football, you're hoping for a rotation mm-hmm. along the defensive line. You'd love to have 8 or 10 players that you can put into those 4 spots. And the Orange at this point might have 4, 5, 6 guys. They're looking to get deeper and deeper as we go along. We've seen already Micah Robinson, Marcus Coleman, Eric Kroom, and Robert Welsh. Those guys are kind of the players who have the job to lose. Now here's another look at a new player, Mitch Kimble. Did not play a year ago, so he's listed as a sophomore, and on a zone read he keeps, and the play blown dead with no gain.
And again, what we're looking at this season as compared to last year is who's going to be that second fiddle at quarterback and who's going to be your guy that backs up Terrell Hunt. But that's not to say, hey, discard these guys. They may not get into a game at all. That's best case scenario. But as you said, you want a rotation on the defensive line and on the offensive line at points as well. You'd like to have a backup quarterback who's extremely serviceable in case of injury. I mean, that's the fact about college football. People are going to get hurt.
Kimble was an all-stater in Illinois. Second team all St. Louis. Coach Schaefer augmenting the yardage on that last play. A little head coach discretion. So instead of no gain, they now give him 4 and set up second down and 6. You can make it up as you go along in the spring.
That's in his contract.
Right. See what Kimble has here. Another tip ball looked like to the right side. Ben Lewis the catch. Josh Kirkland gets him out of bounds. So we've seen some deflected balls on these passes to the perimeter. And again, these guys have been 15 practices of running the same play as the defense isn't getting fooled.
Yeah, they're going to know everything that's coming. However, you do have to have the ability defensively to put your hands up. I mean, that's something that'll frustrate any coach when you come in and you're on the quarterback, you don't have your hands up. So that's good news for the defense.
Job of the tackles to get those hands down. So now first down. And Kimble swallowed up by the pocket, lofts a ball to the sideline that Asher Broyled reels in just inbounds. So Broyled working on a little technique there in front of his team's bench area, and they pick up about six.
Any soccer fans will know that we are in extra time in the first half, undetermined extra time.
Except in soccer, they tell you how much you actually have.
Yeah, they have the guy with the placard over on the side.
Second and four, and a four wide set here. Now Broyled another look. Had to shed a tackler himself. The block not there from Cam McPherson. And Broyled earns the first down on his own, really. Josh Kirkland the tackle. And that, for me, might be the best play of the game so far for the offense.
Well, it shows the muscle of Ashton Broyled to be able to break through a tackle, but also agility. You see the feet there, being able to hop through the tackle and create difficulty for the defense.
Got around Donnie Simmons for the first down. He's working one-on-one with walk-on Eric Jackson. Broyled is. High snap. Kimble with a rocket over the middle and a juggling catch made by Cam McPherson at the 49-yard line. That is a gain of seven for the guy who's now seen the light. He's come to Syracuse back from Georgetown.
Kimball's going to burn a hole through a tight end at some point this season. He keeps throwing it that hard 5 yards away.
Kirkland, the defensive MVP early. Second down and three. Cam is filled out. Folks in the area will remember him as the CBA quarterback. Keeping it on the ground here. Greg Tobias. Walk on running back into the middle for a modest gain to set up third and medium, third and four. Ryan Sloan the tackle.
You talk about Cam McPherson. That's not an offense that's easy to run if you're a big guy either. There's a lot asked of you at CBA here locally to be able to do that zone read type of stuff, and he did it extremely effectively.
Cam's been wearing size 15 shoes since middle school. More out of the shotgun, up-tempo offense, and a completion to Jacob Green, bouncing off a man, and he has the first down up the left sideline to the 44-yard line. Gain of five, and it moves the sticks.
This type of effort the fans like to see, you'd think. Diving at essentially an invisible marker, just trying to pick up as many yards as he can to the outside.
Bouncing off bodies along the way, so now first down at the 44. Green had one regular season catch a year ago. High snap for Kimble. And the late give there to Tobias with a burst of speed. Has the 30, the 25, and the 15-yard line where he's then pulled out of bounds by Eric Anthony. First down. So, again, we're looking at ball handling by the quarterbacks. And not Tobias, I'm sorry, but the standout from a year ago as a freshman, George Morris, showing the electric speed.
It's a pretty deep running back core right now.
Yeah, that's one area where you can never have enough, number one, but the Orange are not terribly concerned, even with the departure of Jerome Smith. Kimble to the end zone, well thrown ball right on time. Jeremiah Kabina, touchdown, and it's 16-5. Kimble with a perfect ball here, and Kabina beat his man up the right sideline.
Well, it's good awareness, too, by Kabina to follow the ball's flight and cut it inside on what might have been a route that was more of a streak route to the outside, but he played it perfectly.
Walk-on kicker Alex Hodgkinson for his second attempt at the extra point has no trouble with it, and so the offense takes a 17-5 lead.
You can tell it's spring football. There are coaches walking behind the plays sometimes.
I think they're going to call that halftime here as Kimble gets a word with quarterback coach Tim Lester. Touchdown passes thrown by a pair of essentially rookie quarterbacks, A.J. Long and Mitch Kimble, hitting Ashton Broyles and Jeremiah Cabina respectively. And they'll call that the first half of this scrimmage completed, as the guys will go in for an opportunity to regroup. Even this part is a rehearsal for the regular season. They'll go in and talk about adjustments and how they go through their halftime routine. There are no preseason games in college football, so this is as close as it gets. We head to the field for a word from Coach Schaefer with Dan Liedtke.
Thanks, Matt. Coach, got to be pleased with the way the offense ended the half there. Heck of a throw.
Yeah, it was a good throw by Mitch, and, you know, he's had a good spring. He started out probably missing first 4 or 5 days with a little bit of a back problem, so it's great to get him back. He's played well. And I thought Ashton Broyles made a real nice play there. George Morris running the ball. You know, it's tough being the head coach now, because now I want that defense to go out there and kick some butt in the second half. So it'll be interesting. 17-5 offense. We ran exactly 44 plays in the first half, which is good. That's a good symbol. But there's some good things going on out there. We'll finish it up here in the second half.
Yeah, you're in an odd spot. What do you cheer for here? I mean, you're trying to keep some balance. How do you do it?
That's the goal. My goal is to try to get that score to where it's balanced. I can put the ball wherever I want, so that's a good thing. So,
thanks for your time, Coach.
Have some fun. You got it. See you a little bit.
Some extra leeway for Scott Schaefer. 17-5 in favor of the offense today at the spring football game. At halftime, we've got a punting competition. Floyd Little as well coming up here on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
And all that you probably are going to have during the regular season. And it's great to see that many people taking advantage. And the defense here, which is trailing 17-5 on the scoring system, will try to take advantage of this punt challenge. They've got an all-conference caliber punter back there in Riley Dixon. But it's not just Dixon. This idea of the Gunners having to beat their men to get down to put the ball on the ground down there, that'll have something to say about where it gets spotted.
So 17-5. And you want to be careful in a game like this not to overanalyze anything that's going on, because certainly you're not playing against ACC competition, and that the defense is not going to be your starting defense at the beginning of the season. But certainly, as Scott Schaefer mentioned, coming off the field talking to Danny Liedtke, there were a couple pops by Ashton Broyles, a couple little surges from him in the first half that were notable.
No question. And he's a guy you know you're going to have on the field in the fall, and is such a great athlete. Was a fantastic high school player at Rush Henrietta All-State. In fact, the state player of the year, represents New York, and has been at this point a guy who's been on the field based on potential. And if he realizes his potential, that young lady and a lot of others in Central New York and throughout Orange Nation will be very happy about it. As you look at Broyles, who was a high school quarterback but has grown into this mold where you could put him anywhere on the field, really. 6'4", 220, and he was really thriving in the long handoff department in the first half.
Well, there was a lot said too in the offseason about just how you feed him information. At points, maybe he was overloaded with the types of stuff that they were throwing at him, and you know, the circumstance now is that you've got the ability to give him a whole package on the outside.
We'll see just how much more he's able to handle. And I think George McDonald has a lot of different tools to deal with here. And if you get him on the perimeter, now he's bigger than the corners you might see elsewhere. So our CBA product, Riley Dixon, ready to punt here. And in his fourth year as the long snapper from State College PA is Sam Rogers. So the kick is back, and he puts the nose of the ball down. Ball hits at the 10. Nobody there to check it up, and so they miss the 15. So what happened there was the Gunner kind of overran the ball. And that's an offer where Dixon really kind of did his part, like a wedge shot into the 10-yard line.
You've been working on your punt breakdown, haven't you?
A little bit, yeah.
Good at that.
Looks like Sean Avant missed his spot, and so the coaches will try to get him organized for this next one. He's not in the second rep, so no points on the first try for Dixon. Jeremiah Cabina, Gunner, gets good position this time down. Can't find the ball, though, as it hits the 5, checks up, and now Cabina recovers. That also hit the defensive player, so that one they mark, I believe, at the 6. So that's 2 points.
Do you get a turnover for that because it hit the defensive player? Shouldn't they get?
That's right. Could have been almost a muffed kick on the defense. So that's 2 points. We'll call it 17-7 right now. Oh, they're going to go. Okay. They're getting generous. Another Scott Schaefer discretionary point.
Well, he's a philanthropist. We know that. He does a lot of work in the community.
He's giving.
Giving today.
He just offered to match all the tickets bought for the Villanova game August 29th. This kick popped up a bit more than Dixon would have hoped. Hit to the 10, a forward bounce, and Avant is there. Could have let it go a little further for that extra point. I think they'll mark that one outside the 5. So call that 2 points and make it 17-10.
Well, you mentioned Scott Schaefer willing to match every ticket bought for that Villanova game. And essentially, Scott Schaefer is buying you dinner as a community. Yeah. He's saying, hey, look, on me, come to the game. I want you there so much that I want to buy you a ticket.
One more try here for Riley Dixon and company.
That
so a chance
the,
at maybe as many as 5 more points. Low snap, though. That can't be good. And he gets it away. What if it would have been blocked in a real game? Kobina down there as it hits inside the 5, bounces back. Kobina with not a ton of urgency tags it down to the 9 for 2 more points. Let's call it 17-12. You know, going back to the idea of Schaefer buying the ticket here, I think Schaefer is very much of this community, and the people that have gotten to know him hopefully have taken advantage of that. He's from Ohio. He's the son of a high school football coach. He loves the game. He loves teaching. As his mission is stated, he just hopes to win enough to keep the job long enough to make the relationships that are so important to him. And he does such a great job. He's a great father. See Wolf and Elsa here, and Coach Schaefer's wife Missy here. So if you buy a ticket, get another one on Schaefer. And he's a kind of guy that I think would fit right in any community around here in Central New York.
Well, you mentioned Wolf, too, a quarterback that was a standout at Fayetteville Manly as high school. We watched him a couple of times on our airwaves, and a tremendous player, and you can see why from Scott Schaefer and his ability. He's really got that second gear as a person, you know, even talking before the game today. He's just sitting there chatting with you, and then he gets really just fired up and emotional about the game. But people love to see that. I mean, he really does just want to get out there and have fun, but win and do it the right way.
It's a great expression, and taking part in so many public appearances with Coach Schaefer so far in his first year as head coach. I know he does that. He hits the couple of bullet points a little bit out of his notebook, and then that second gear you're talking about, then it's just passion and talking off the cuff, and he loves interacting with people. AJ Long to start this second half of the scrimmage. Maybe Terrell Hunt's day is done, and Long shows some explosiveness on a run off the left side, but they blow it dead for safety after a gain of a yard. Darius Kelly on the stop.
You know, he's tough on a
tempo too.
He's tough on a speech writer, though, because when you go off message and you just do the passion thing, he does. He talks off the cuff, and I think people love that.
We'd rather have that than the alternative. As Long whips one out to the perimeter again, and on the edge is Adrian Fleming, who's sort of been the number two to Ashton Broyles so far. Not much there. Generous spotting ahead to the 23-yard line. Wayne Morgan on the stop, and now another third and medium. Third and 6. 17-12. The offense has 2 touchdown passes and a 27-yard field goal. Long to throw again. Early entry freshman bounces it incomplete, meant for Brizzly Esteem. That's a punt forced by the defense, so give them another point. 17-13.
You and I thought maybe
three and out. So yeah.
You and I thought maybe before the game that the defense got the point system swayed toward it, but at this point, it looks like the offense has certainly benefited a little. As you see, DeAndre Smith, the running backs coach, and he has a very deep stable that he's seeing progress this season.
You get excited about because he's working at it. Again, pass protection was not something he was asked to do a lot of. So he's every day is just a little bit better in what he's doing. So again, that's out through the work. You can see that, and those runs and the quickness and things that he can see. And then once he sees it, his body is kind of used to doing certain movements that we do in drills. So it was great to see that.
He's talking about George Morris there, DeAndre Smith, one of the running backs that's a key for the Orange this season.
Three and out that last time for the defense to bring them to within 2 at 17-15. Short carry by the veteran Prince Tyson Gully. Ron Thompson and Donnie Simmons get him down. So now another chance at a three and out here for the defense. They could take the lead if they get off the field on this play. And that's a sack. Great rush by Thompson to bring down A.J. Long. So add three more to the defense and now an 18-17 lead as that side of the ball has surged in front.
And as we said, the defense is going to be the significant strength of this team this season. I mean, it flip-flops back and forth, but you see the individual effort right there to break through, get the sack. And what we're watching for in a game like this is, yes, individual bursts, but also everybody stay healthy and the amount of energy that fills the dome to have it be a fun day for everybody watching.
So far, so good. A couple of minor bumps and bruises. The center, John Miller, came out of a play very early, but he's been back in and has played plenty. He's in there at center right now with Rob Trudeau, who's a starting left guard, but filling in at right guard today. George McDonald will put all this in the computer and spit out something cohesive for August. Mitch Kimble in at quarterback now. Again, out of the gun and an up-tempo setup here. Adonis Amin Moore at the back, and Kimble brought down in the backfield by Donnie Simmons. Simmons with so much speed. That's what Tim Doust likes about him. Redshirted in 2011. Has not played a great deal the past a couple of seasons, but might in the fall. 5 yard loss, second, and let's call it 14. Kimble off the hands of Josh Parrish, could have been picked, but Simmons a little shy on the dive. Third and 14 coming now.
Well, just to be clear, you're not going to win a job, you're not going to lose a job from this one game, but it's part of practice, and if you have a spectacular effort, just like any day in practice, people are going to take note as you watch the film, and maybe that gives you a bump.
Cameron Lynch with a nice play, stepping in there at the linebacker position. Pass to the near side is brought in by Kinte Funderburk, the Arkansas transfer that people had high hopes on, but that did not materialize a year ago. And again, it could in the fall. Dyshawn Davis the stop for another three and out. And so that's a good run for the defense to extend the lead now to 21-7. Three straight three and outs. Again, with reserve quarterbacks in there, A.J. Long and Mitch Kimble. We have not yet seen Austin Wilson, who came in with Kimble in the same kind of ilk.
Well, this defense, as you mentioned, Matt, has rattled off, including the punt competition, 16 straight points for defensive coordinator Chuck Bulla. And here's somebody who likes to see that development from his players, even right here in April.
It's progressing nicely, never enough for a coach. We always want more and more and more. But you just got to go in stages here, and as Coach Schaefer has mentioned to everybody and how we mentioned to everybody, we just want to be on an upward trend when we hit the end of spring ball. So where we started, we want to move up, and by the end of, we're going to have a couple dips, and then you're going to go up, and a couple dips, you're going to go up. But at the end, we should be hitting on the rise as we leave spring ball and getting the young men into their summer workouts.
Important to note, too, that after this, we're closing up spring practice. This is the final opportunity to evaluate for somebody like Chuck Bulla, a veteran coach, and what he's looking at is the final thing he's going to see. Then the coaches are going to go out on the recruiting trail, have school visits coming up next, leading up to the fall.
And through the summer, you're leaning on your captains, your leaders, whether you've named them as captains or not, to run practices. Here is Austin Wilson for the first time, and his first pass is complete to a fellow youngster, Corey Winfield, who has a first down up the left side.
A lot of coaches will tell you, too, the best teams that they have are the ones that self-police anyway, so it's an opportunity to evaluate that in terms of progress and what you see when they come back and get together in front of you.
So the offense here at the 48-yard line with a first down for Wilson out of Camp Hill, Pennsylvania. Adonis Amin Moore, the carry off the right side for a gain of one. He's about half the man he used to be. The highly touted high school player, very, very productive in Denver, but a bigger guy, used really as a fullback early in his career here, but they may put him out there as the regular running back a little bit, and he might offer something in the neighborhood of a Jerome Smith, that bigger punishing back. Gain of two, second and eight. Wilson to throw for Broyles up the right sideline. He's got it for another first down. Broyles with great position there is out of bounds at the 18-yard line. Gain of 32.
Not a bad throw at all. Faded a little bit toward the sideline. Could have been a touchdown, but you put it right over the shoulder and give the receiver an opportunity and nobody else a chance to catch it.
Good pass blocking. Alex Hayes in the offensive line right now, holding up the protection there. First down, and Kobina on the screen behind the line of scrimmage. Steps out of the tackle of Ulrich Perry and on the reverse, covering the width of the field. Another good block, springing Kobina up the left sideline for the touchdown from 18 yards out. A whale of a block sprung him free.
Well, you got to love Wilson, too, at least getting in the mix. I mean, you don't want the quarterback to get hurt on a play like this, but he at least put himself in between Kobina and a defender, and you've got the opportunity to get into the end zone.
So Kobina, who's never been afraid to run 150 yards to gain 30, does something on that order here. The key block is by a player who's not currently on the ring roster that's been given to us, 77. I don't know if that may have been Jamar McGloster, who's been wearing 65 or not. A couple of number changes necessitated by the uniform supply at this stretch, but that was the death blow for the defense on that play as Kobina scores the third touchdown for the offense, the extra point good for Alex Hodgkinson, and so it's now 24-21. Kobina with two touchdowns.
Well, he could be the star of the game. I mean, people are looking for those bright spots, and when you get into the end zone, people are going to take notice. But those are a couple nice moves. You know, it's sometimes you look and you say, boy, why is he giving up so much ground? Why doesn't he just run straight ahead and all that? And some people are just more effective that way. Some people just have the ability to make you miss.
And really, I would say, let's discount the Kobina pass from 15 yards out from Kimball. The touchdowns by Broiled and certainly this last one for Kobina, they're running plays. Those are, for all intents and purposes, running plays. It'll go in the stats maybe as a pass, but that was thrown behind the line of scrimmage. It did not bear fruit on the right sideline with the blocking they were looking for there, but he was able to make something happen. And it's the playmaking talent that gets better as your recruiting gets better. And so they hope that is, well, they know it's trending up in the program. During the lean years of recent, there weren't playmaking, game-changing players that they hope are in uniform now and in the fall.
And as you get more of those players, you're also going to get receivers, and you're able to recruit receivers who are better blockers because you know you have game-changers at the other receiver spots. You can bring in a guy who might be a more possession-oriented player, and then you have differentiated abilities rather than a lot of the same guy.
Haven't seen a great deal of Terrell Hunt. We know it's his job come the fall. Austin Wilson with another series here, and his pass to Corey Cooper is blown up by Josh Kirkland for a loss of five back to the 25. So Kirkland has really shown brightly defensively. He gets to a guy like Cooper, who was very heavily recruited and a guy that the staff waited on for a bit to get into uniform.
Well, that's another play that you can take and say, no matter what type of game this is, you get off your block, blow up a bubble screen, that's going to translate.
Absolutely. And so guys are looking to put the best plays on film at this stage. Second and 15 for Wilson. And a good arm over the middle for the first down to Cooper. Up to the 46-yard line, a strike of 21. Wilson's calling card is the laser beam he's got in his right arm.
That was a low-flying, absolute dart over the middle. And that's good news for SU fans.
Chauncey Schism the tackle. Wilson was a javelin thrower, a baseball pitcher, topping out at 92 in high school. First down here at the 46.
You ever throw a javelin?
Not once. I caught a few. Ball tipped and caught by Broiled. He makes a man miss and has another first down. Running up the numbers, and Broiled rambling into the open field. Broiled's got a touchdown from long range. 54 yards, and Broiled is in the paint for the second time in this spring game.
That's the other thing you want to see in a game like this, maybe, is when you've got a first-string wide receiver on the outside who's supposed to break tackles for you, and he looks like that against a defense that might be overmatched against him. You'd like to see a play like that.
Ashton broiled with explosiveness. We haven't seen him in real regular season games run away from anybody. If that's something that he can bring come the fall, it is a new dimension for him. Alex Hodgkinson perfect on the extra points today. Offense up 31-21 as we check it again on the field. Dan Liedtke with a defensive leader from a year ago, Jay Bromley.
Thanks very much, Matt. Well, just saw the touchdown there from Ashton. You had a chance to see him a lot in practice, and that was really a nice explosive move. What was he like from your perspective in practice?
He was everything that he just did, you know, explosive, quick, make a lot of guys miss. It makes me happy to see him do things like that, but in my head as a defensive player, I'm like, no, I can't let that go down. I can't let it happen.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit more about, are there any unsung heroes over here on the offensive side that maybe you see as this coming season maybe are going to break out that the typical Orange fan may not be aware of? And on the defensive side for that matter?
I mean, for the most part, I think you have the guys you already know about, like, you know, the Davises, the Lynches, but the Eskridges on defense. But, you know, you got guys on that defensive line looking to step up. Krumies, the Rob, the Welshes, the Mike, the Robinsons, and the Williams, those guys are really looking to step up. And, you know, as far as offenses goes, it's going to be really good to see the offensive line, period, just seeing how they hold up, you know, coming back together strong and, you know, everybody getting healthy. And, you know, 10 coming back for a big season, man. It'll be interesting, man. I feel like this season they have a lot of guys come out of the blue nobody really knew about.
What have you seen on the defensive side of the ball today that's impressed you the most?
Just, you know, them getting to the ball. They run a lot of quick screens, a lot of things like that. So pursuit is very big in that part of the game. So I like to see them run. I've seen the big boys run. And the linebackers, you know, shedding block, making plays.
We've heard a lot about, you know, Coach Schaefer and his personality. From your perspective, what was it about him that really got you motivated to go out there and play football?
His enthusiasm, his will to win. You know, he made sure he pushes hard each and every practice in camp so that we know whatever we went through in camp and practice, the games are going to be way easier than that.
Really quick, Floyd Little mentioned a story to me about an ice cream truck at practice last year. I got to hear about that.
Yeah, he did. One time after practice, he had an ice cream truck drive on the field and gave us all, you know, different assortments of ice cream. That was real cool.
Flavor?
Me, I'm a chocolate man.
Yeah, it's a good call. I'm kind of playing Jane. I stick with the vanilla. Those guys are up there talking about javelin. You guys ever throw? You ever play jarts when you were little?
I never played jarts when I was little.
You guys play jarts up there, Matt, Jason?
Lawn? Is that lawn darts? Is that
jarts?
What
they don't
about?
Even sell them anymore. I think
play jarts
a lot
or
of lawsuits
jorts.
Out there.
It's a fine line.
The we're going to talk some more
both.
Ice cream. Take it away.
Danny, thank you. And touchdown drive for Austin Wilson, the young quarterback, the sophomore from Pennsylvania, for his coach, the quarterback's coach, Tim Lester.
It's been fun to have the depth that we've had. You know, last year we were really short on numbers and really short on anyone that had taken any real reps in a game situation. So having Hunt in the room helps a lot. He is I think a junior. He's got 2 years left, and he's by far the oldest in the room because everybody else is 18 or 19. So it's definitely a young room, but it's a lot of talent, and they're eager to learn, and it's been fun.
It's Tim Lester, quarterback's coach for SU, and the offense leads 31-21 behind Austin Wilson, who looked pretty good on that touchdown drive.
He did, and I want to go back and identify, if we get a moment, 77 in white. It's a uniform number change of a player that people will remember from a year ago. He made a couple of good blocks on the last couple of large explosive gains for the offense. George Morris with a carry off the right side here. You remember, and you'll know him, Jason, from your neck of the woods. Kendall Moore is a Chicago guy. Last year wore uniform number 87 and played tight end. Now they've kind of developed him, thought he'd be a tackle down the road, hadn't really filled out to that a year ago, and so got on the field as a tight end. Now a tackle, and he's made a couple of nice blocks. There's a pass interference on a throw over the middle. Late flag. Grizzly Esteem drawing the flag from Darius Kelly.
You've got the scoring system in front of you. What can a flag be redeemed for?
That's right. You could trade that in for some points. Now in the NFL, that's about a 25-yard penalty, but doesn't quite work that way here, and I think we'll see some coaches' discretion in this case.
But Kendall Moore last year had a few games where people said, boy, maybe he could really step in as a tight end. He seemed to know his way around. He's a big body, and we'll see how he does wearing 77 now.
So they'll mark it off to a 15-yard penalty now. And first and 10 of the 41. This right now, this is a program right now, okay? You've won 3 out of 4. They've got plans. They're recruiting players better. They have a vision about slotting them into the right spot or even opportunities to develop from one position to another, for instance. Kimball cannot evade the rush. Marcus Coleman up the middle for a sack. Kimball's first option was not there up the left sideline, and Coleman would have buried him had it not been for the whistle.
But you're talking about where this program is, and it is an extremely viable, upward-trending program, but it happens in steps as well. You're talking about recruiting. You go from this level to the next level to the next level in terms of recruiting, and every season's big, but it was great to see the finish last year and the way that they wound out the season.
8-yard sack there, and on second down and long, Marquise Hodge breaking up a pass over the middle meant for Adrian Fleming. Darius Kelly's done a nice job making some plays as well. And now third and very long. Quarterback Mitch Kimball sat out all of last year. Another one of these guys that played multiple sports in high school. Back to throw and has a nice catch by Esteem for a first down and more. A stiff fly, but he's free up the right sideline. Brizzly Esteem speeding into the red zone and knocked out of bounds just shy of the goal line. Brizzly Esteem may be the fastest player on the team. He essentially won the Texas Bowl. He wants to come out after expending the injury there. Julian Wiggum on the stop, and Wiggum slow to get up. More run after catch here. He had it at the 45 and got out of Richie DeSeer's tackle and outran Wiggum. Chauncey Schism helped there too to get him out of bounds at the 3. That's a gain of 64.
Good work by Jared West, at least getting downfield to try and make himself useful. He was roving in space to see if he could get a block down there to finish off the run. But boy, Brizzly Esteem, that speed, if he's better and faster than last season, you would have to believe he would be a large weapon for this offense this year.
It was one of the great X and O plays of the year for Scott Schaefer, putting in Esteem, who was only sporadically a punt returner last year, but they needed a little something more than a fair catch to get into position to win the Texas Bowl, and Esteem made that happen. So now look for George Morris here on goal to go at the 3. He's the back to the left of quarterback Mitch Kimball, and it is Morris getting the call, but upended at the 5-yard line, a loss of 2. Eric Kroom overseeing the tackle there. Richie DeSeer coming up from his safety spot. Offense could, in essence, put the game away. A lot of times you'll see coaching staffs will put something on the line, some stakes, so to speak, pun intended, whether that's S-T-A-K-E or S-T-E-A-K. Nothing officially on the line here in this one, but sometimes it's hot dogs for the losers and steaks for the winners. The coaching staff will compete more than anything, offense, defense. There's a timeout taken offensively here by Scott Schaefer and his crew.
So Scott Schaefer has an addition to his coaching staff as well this season, and a player that you might recognize, a Syracuse Orange fan, as you are watching this game. It's Sariki Diabati, and here's Scott Schaefer on his newest coach.
Young man from the Ivory Coast, Sariki Diabate. You talk about trying to live the American dream, and I call baloney on that, that people say that the American dream isn't still alive, because you got a kid in Sariki Diabate that was in one of the worst neighborhoods in the world, where you had ethnic cleansing going on, and his mom and dad got him out of there. They sent him to the Bronx, New York, and he was speaking French. And then all of a sudden he figured out, hey, I kind of like this football, this American football. And his high school coach talked him into playing it. And ironically enough, he comes from Lehman High School, the same school that Doug Marrone came from. All of a sudden we recruit him here out of the junior college, Nassau community, and he ends up becoming an unbelievable leader. And I really believe the reason he was so great with our players was because he appreciated every day he had in this country. And he grew up hard in the Bronx, but he appreciated the opportunity that if you work hard and you go to class and you take care of your homework and you do a good job getting your degree, that you get opportunities in life in this country. And Syracuse gave him the opportunity, and we were so blessed to have him. And he was a silent leader when he walked in here. And he had to take his mindset to another level. And now he's going to get a master's degree. He's working as a graduate assistant football coach for us right now. And he's going to walk away from Syracuse with a master's degree. I guarantee you, when he was 12 years old and coming across, you know, to this new country, he had a lot of fear in his belly. But I like to think that his relationships through sport have really made him who he is. And now he's going to walk away, you know, a proud man that can go out and influence society in a positive way.
Siriki Diabate, a great emotional leader, actually did it a little bit last year for the Syracuse defense. He's still young enough to be closely connected to the players. It's a great story of what's possible in college sports in general, but specifically here at Syracuse, where you come, you get a great degree. If you put in the work that's asked of you, great things are possible. And Siriki, a great link to that, as Darrell Smith was prior to him. Defense holding on that goal to go situation. It was third and goal, or first and goal rather, from the three, and the defense forces a field goal attempt instead of giving up a touchdown. Alex Hodgkinson has looked solid, asked to do the basics today, and he puts the offense in front 34-21.
All we need is a pick 13 to tie the game. The touchdown,
you might get that,
and the turnover together.
Dr. Daryl Gross's booth there. You see the athletic director in blue in the middle, and women's basketball coach Quentin Hilsman in the neon yellow there.
Congratulations to Coach Q on the first NCAA tournament victory for his ladies, and almost even shorthanded with the injury to Brittany Sykes in the first round. Almost beat Kentucky on the Wildcats' home floor. So a great season for the ladies in basketball.
There's a guy who has made as much with what he was given as anybody. Steve Gregory played on both sides of the ball for Paul Pasqualoni here at Syracuse and has had a great NFL career with the Chargers and Patriots. Steve, on your left there, about to be a father. Moved back to the area in the offseason, so we wish him the best in NFL free agency.
He just got better, it seemed like, every year in the NFL. We saw him coming up through Syracuse, and he was a very good player, but you didn't think, you know, 10-year NFL guy necessarily at the outset, and absolutely the progress that he showed was amazing.
Really could run and played defensive back and wide receiver here. And in the NFL, he's just found the niche. He's a smart player, does the right things, and he's played two good places. And right now for Bill Belichick most recently, a dropped snap by A.J. Long. And so it's another play for a loss offensively. The defense is not missing opportunities to take advantage of missteps by the offense. Offense with a lead of 34-21. Biggest lead of the game in this modified scoring system. But again, a pick six, which you could have right in this neighborhood, would be a pick 13. This one's tipped. You got an opportunity. It's brought in by Darius Kelly. Can he get loose? No. But they'll have 6 points for the turnover. And now 34-27.
You got to lateral that, don't you?
Absolutely. Right. Go for the unprecedented pick 13.
A rare opportunity for the pick 13. So back to the drawing board for the offensive coordinator and assistant head coach, George McDonald.
I think we're right on track. You know, when I went to the University of Minnesota, we started off really slow. The second year, we really made a big jump. And the same thing at the University of Miami. We kind of went through some growing pains. And in the second year, together as a staff, we usually make the same jump. And right now, we're making that jump consistent with the other programs I've been in. So it's really exciting.
George McDonald, with a background at Miami, was going to go to Arkansas before the opportunity opened up here with Coach Schaefer at Syracuse. And an end around by Devontae McFarland. Chauncey Schism, his escort, over the sideline at the 17-yard line. Gain of two and change for McFarland.
Important to note, too, as we tick down to 3 minutes to go, three timeouts remaining for the defense if they care to.
Yes.
Approximately stop the clock. The offense with just the two timeouts left. Scott Schaefer burned one too early, don't you think?
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see if they put the clamps on and how seriously they want to take the end of the game situation. They may go to a two-minute drill as we see Sean Avant get a first down. Again, run after the catch. There haven't been too many balls thrown downfield today, but the emphasis has been put on playmaking on the perimeter. So first down for the offense, which has a seven-point lead. A.J. Long at quarterback, all-stater in Tennessee. He's an early enrollee. He was a guy who recruited a lot of the freshman class we'll see in the fall. Another chance for Ashton Broyles with two touchdowns today. Inside the numbers to the 30, looking for a block, and he's up over the 35 to the 37-yard line. Oliver Vigil helps Ron Thompson on the tackle as we head again to the sidelines. And Dan Liebke.
Thanks very much, Matt. Here with Marquise Spruill, and Mackey's over here giving you a lot of trouble. What's this defense got to do to keep him quiet?
Really just run to the ball because he's doing a lot of screen type plays. So, you know, just to get us all spread out and out of whack, double screens, bubble screens, all types of things like that. So, really just run to the ball, make sure you get there with a pop, you know.
You've got an NFL workout under your belt. You're getting ready for the draft. What are some of the things you're focusing on to get those drafts' attention on you come draft day?
It's really not much I could do. You know, they've seen my film. They came to pro day. You know, they call if they want to have conversations. But other than that, I just got to stay in shape because they tell me the thing that the coach hates the most is when you come to camp out of shape. So that's all I'm doing, staying in shape. So.
Who's going to pull this out here at the end? I know you're pulling hard for that defense.
I think defense is going to take it.
Guys, there's your prediction on the record. Back upstairs.
All right, we don't quibble with Marquise Spruill, a guy that's that big and that punishing. Whatever he says goes. So we'll stick with his prediction.
Had that nice hello, my name is Marquise Spruill name tag, too, just in case people didn't recognize
him. That's more than the number 11 that he used to wear. A.J. Long trying to spin out of trouble. Pressure put on by Robert Welsh and the play blown dead. Marcus Coleman in there to combine on the sack as well as we're starting to near the close of today's scrimmage. Still an opportunity for the defense. And this has worked out well, the scoring system. The previous scrimmage would have broken out to about 38-32 offense, and we're seeing on the order of the same thing today. Third and 7 coming here for A.J. Long. Escapes Cameron Lynch. Gets to the 50 for the first down. Oh, no, they blow it down. Not quite generous enough to give them the first down as they keep the quarterback upright. And Schaaf now making it up as he goes along.
Now.
Oh, I think that's it. Can ensure nobody else gets hurt. Let's see if he brings it. Yeah, bringing everybody in here with the final 20 seconds. They'll run off the clock. And I think both coaching staff, both sides, will have things that they'll feel good about, Jason, and also lots of things that are room for improvement through the summer.
And that would be the hope. You'd hope that you'd have things that you can move forward with and things that you can say, hey, look, in the last 15 practices, we've gotten better at X, Y, and Z. Some great work by Ashton Broyles on the outside offensively. We saw Dyshawn Davis early on the defensive side have some great success too. So Syracuse's offense wins 34-27 in this spring game, and Scott Schaefer will address the troops.
This is where Schaaf does a great job messaging to his team about what they've been through, what's coming up next. Certainly the plans and the meetings and all of those things, that's not what they're addressing with here, but we'll try to eavesdrop if we can at midfield.
Hey, listen, great spring. I'm proud of you guys. We did a lot of good things throughout the course of this spring. Now what we got to do, like we talked the other day, is take this into the summer. You guys hear what I'm saying, Sean? I need my elders to step up to the plate and take charge this summer. When the coaches aren't around, we got good coaches with our seniors. You guys got me? Now listen, when we finish up right here, we're going to go over and we're going to sign autographs at the tables. They're setting them up right now. Remember what we talked about? Let's do a good job talking especially to the kids, the little ones. You guys with me? Anybody got any questions? All right, good. Make sure we're smart tonight. Take care of each other. Sean Hickey, come on up here and get a drink with everybody. Woo!
When you go in, your stuff is in there. Should we shower first? Just towel off.
So you heard Scott Schaefer talking ostensibly to Sean Hickey there at first just to say, hey, look, as we go into the summer, you're part of my crew to make sure that everything is ship-shape.
Right. They haven't really adorned captains just yet, but you can think of who the suspects are going to be. Sean Hickey's a leader. On defense, Cam Lynch is a leader. Those are the types of guys that at least will be your de facto captains until you decide you want to anoint one and or two or four. And those guys will lead the summer workouts, as will Terrell Hunt. The quarterback's always a captain.
Let's check in downstairs. Danny Liedke on the sideline. Dan.
Let's go that way.
Yeah, we're going to avoid the forklift here, guys. It's I've run into a few of them and lost, obviously. this face, coach, I've lost a few of those battles.
Yeah.
What do you take away from this game? A lot of great effort out there.
Yeah, it was. You know, I think we got 79 plays in, right around 80, which was the goal. And I think we came away pretty healthy, which was one of the biggest goals for us because we are banged up a little bit. Saw some good plays made by some kids that haven't played a ton of football for us, which was good to see. And then I saw some of our good players make plays. I thought Ashton Broad's play was great, really a couple of them. Brisley made some good plays. I thought Terrell Hunt did a nice job running the first team offense. You know, kind of tough with the scoring system. We're not hitting the quarterback, so I kind of felt bad for the defense because I think we would have had some big hits on the quarterback a couple times that could change things. But, you know, biggest thing is I really appreciated the crowd coming out here. We got a great community that we can't wait to represent this fall, and we're just looking forward to kicking it off against Villanova.
Coach, we wish you nothing but the best.
Thanks
for your time so much.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, sir. Back upstairs.
Danny, Coach Schaefer, thank you. Those posters will be signed very shortly. Autographs on the field at the Carrier Dome. We'll wrap it up from Syracuse. 34-27 the offense in the spring game. He's out. The autograph line begins for the players down on the field for the youngsters to get everything signed as we wrap up the spring game. From the Carrier Dome with Matt Park, Jason Benetti along with you. And they're like caged animals playing against each other, not in front of anybody, and now they have the opportunity to do it. What's your takeaway?
Right, well, hit somebody and hit somebody without the padding on your helmet and that type of thing. I think the biggest takeaway is that the momentum of the program continues here. Nothing we saw today would slow the enthusiasm for the fall.
It's a good sign. 34-27, the offense gets the victory, and very few injuries in the game, which is also good news for Scott Schaefer's crew. So for Danny Wake, for Jay Bromley, Mackie McPherson, and Matt Park, the voice of the Orange, Jason Benetti, saying good day from the Carrier Dome. Lacrosse is next, Hobart and Syracuse from Geneva. Enjoy your weekend.